Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our last session on the series that we've been in for a couple months now on the power of music in the gospel. We've been looking, starting last week, we've been looking at songs that had Christian themes, and sometimes I put that in quotes because they might talk about Jesus in the storyline, but sometimes they didn't go real deep. Others actually were excellent. And one of the songs we're going to listen to right now is one of those songs that actually broke into a lot of churches. I know some churches actually included it in their hymnal and would sing this song. Particularly in our youth groups, we would hear this song sung. And it's based on a hymn that was written in 1931. And this song through the years was sung many times at funeral services, sometimes in children's services. Cat Stevens recorded. He's not the first one to have recorded it, but obviously it became a big hit. In fact, it went to number 11 on the charts in 1971. So let's listen to Cat Stevens singing "Morning Has Broken." And
morning has broken like the first morning. Blackbird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden saw play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new.
That was Cat Stevens singing "Morning Has Broken." I'm going to have to step out of sharing for a second. And so I apologize for that. and you don't follow a routine, it doesn't like it. Oops. All right. Now we got it. All right. So the next song we want to listen to was a song that came out. It was first released by a Canadian by the name of Anne Murray. She released this song. It was later released by this group called Ocean. I don't know Ocean. This might have been one of those one-hit wonders. You know, they became a hit. It went to number two. The reason why I didn't get to number one, because there was another song by Three Dog Night called Joy to the World. And we remember Jeremiah was a bullfrog. Had really nothing to do with, as we know, Joy to the World. So Billy Graham, actually, when this song was released, sent a note to this group thanking them and commending them for the release of the song. The lyrics are really good. And as I said, it went all the way to number two in 1971. So Put Your Hand in the Hand. We're waiting for the little wheel to get started here. Here we go. So the next song we want to listen to was a song that was released in 1972. It only made it to number 35 on the charts. This song was originally written by a gospel singer by the name of Art Reynolds in 1966. Yeah, remember, this is in the middle of that incredible decade, right? And the message was simple. All he wanted to say is Jesus is just all right. with me, Jesus is just all right. Oh yeah, Jesus is just all right. Now the verse that went with it, I don't care what they may say. I don't care what they may do. I don't care what they may say. Jesus is just all right. Now, not really complicated lyrics, are they? You know, pretty simple, straightforward. Now, the Doobie Brothers, when they released their version of it, they added a bridge, which actually became known for many people. And the bridge was, Jesus, he's my friend. Jesus, he's my friend. He took me by the hand and led me far from this land. Now, they don't say it in the song what land the world they're talking about. Jesus, he's my friend. Now, let's go back to what is Jesus is just all right with me. It's American slang in the 60s when you said just all right, which meant something that was cool or hip. In other words, you got to remember now where we're at. We're 66, 67 is going to be the outbreak of the Jesus movement. And what Art Reynolds is trying to say, you know, Jesus is pretty cool. Now, I'm not so sure we'd say that today, or maybe you never said it, but in the context in which it said, that was a pretty powerful statement. Now, this song got covered by lots of people, including the Byrds, actually released a version in 1969, and then the Doobie Brothers. Now, I'm just going to say this. In 1992, DC Talk, which was a Christian rock hip-hop group, actually took the arrangement that we're going to listen to in just a moment by the Doobie Brothers, and they added hip-hop or rap to it. And if you ever have a chance to look at it, not that you all are going to rush out and do that tomorrow, the lyrics are most fascinating on what they wrote in the rap, because these guys were Christians and they were wanting to take, all right, yeah, Jesus is cool, but they wanted to say something more substantive than just Jesus is cool, okay? But you got to understand, this is what the secular radio stations were playing. So let's listen. We're not going to listen to the whole thing. We'll just listen to a portion of Jesus is Just All Right, because it's just a lot of the same lyrics over and over again. That go on, because they will repeat that and they'll go back to Jesus is just all right. I got to remember who's listening to this. It's probably not people being raised in the church, and probably not my parents' generation, or even your generation. But I remember being in the youth groups. And of course, I had graduated from college or high school by this time. I was in college during this period when this came out. And we were just baffled as a kid raised in the church that I had my friends who had never darkened the church singing about Jesus. It just blew my mind. And it really did provide some opportunities to talk about Jesus in a way you never could before, because I wasn't even sure what they knew what they were singing when they were singing that song and this type of thing. So it became an interesting one. Now, another song that came out is one that we're all familiar with, comes out of country. It's Kris Kristofferson's Why Me, Lord? And I'm going to play this. It's a longer version because in the beginning, he explains how he wrote this song, what was the context, which I think you'll find very interesting. And then he sings. Now, anyone notice who's sitting next to
Willie?
Yeah, Willie's sitting there, yes. So anyway, so let's enjoy this.
And Kris, before we do it, I'd like for you to tell the story of Why Me, Lord. I think it was inspired by Larry Gatlin, wasn't it?
Well, I was moved by a song I heard him singing in church.
Was it Help Me?
Help Me.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, yeah, it was.
Wasn't it?
Jimmy Snow's church.
You took Connie Smith to church, or she took you to church?
She took me to church. We had the night before, we'd been down in Cookeville with a bunch of people doing a benefit for Dottie West's high school band or something. Mm-hmm. And then Connie took me over to church the next day to Jimmy Snow's church.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a profound religious experience during the session, something that I never had happened to me before. And Why Me came out of it.
It was a very personal experience then.
Yes, it was. Everybody was kneeling down, and Jimmy said something like, "If anybody's lost, please raise their hand." And I was kneeling there, and I don't go to church a lot. And the notion of raising my hand was out of the question. And I thought, I can't imagine who's doing this. And all of a sudden, I felt my hand going up. And I was hoping nobody else was looking, because everybody had their head over, bend over, praying. And then he said, if anybody is ready to except Jesus, something like this, come down to the front of the church. And I thought that would never happen. And I found myself getting up and walking down with all these people and going down there. And I don't really know what he said to me. He said something to me like, "Are you ready to accept Jesus Christ in your life," or something. And I said, "I don't know. I didn't know what I was doing there." And he put me down, said, "Kneel down here." And I can't even remember what he was saying, but whatever it was such a release for me that I found myself weeping in public. I felt this forgiveness that I didn't know I even needed.
Could we get you and Janie Fricke and Willie to do this?
We'll sing harmony. You Ooh. Bet.
Well, right we'll here. Try. I'll do it in G, and I hope I don't mess up the band again.
Lord, what have I ever done to deserve even one of the pleasures I've known? Tell me, Lord, what did I ever do
that was worth loving you for the kindness you've shown. Lord, help me, Jesus, I've wasted it. So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I need you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand.
Try me, Lord, if you think there's a way I can try to repay all I've taken from you. Maybe, Lord, I can show someone else what I go through myself on my way back to you.
So help me, Jesus, I know what I am. Now that I know that I need you, so help me, Jesus, my soul's in your hand. Jesus, my soul.
Because of that song, he was invited to Dallas in the summer of 1972. We talked about this several weeks ago, to Expo 72. The main speaker was Billy Graham. And they brought all these musicians, country, the new rock and roll, pop, everything else. We played some of the songs several weeks ago that there. And it's, you know, coming out of that country tradition, it really grabbed people's attention in a way. Very thoughtful lyrics. And I think that's what makes for good lyrics. Yes, there is a joy that can come singing lyrics, but sometimes it just, as you reflect on them, they just speak to your heart in ways in the depths of your heart. And you can tell he had an encounter with God that was not just some surface thing. Now, I'm not going to say that he got his life totally together, but then I'm not so sure that can be said of any of us. But great, great song. We're going to do a couple more songs before we wrap up today. And oh, by the way, just so I'm reminding everyone, today we will finish up this study. And next week we'll be getting a study on the minor prophets. We're calling it Majoring on the Minor. But I wanted to take a break here looking at music in terms of operas. Because during this period of that Jesus Revolution from 1967 to 1972, as we've been listening to last week and this week, there were songs that were popping up on the charts that everybody was listening to. Well, in the, you know, plays that were taking place, there were two big ones that took place. Jesus was on the cover of Time magazine. I believe that was 71, if not 71 or 72. And the two musicals were written. The first one was by Wright and Lloyd Webber. They were in their 20s and they wrote Jesus Christ Superstar. Now, they had previously written a 20-minute little school cantata called Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat. That also came, in fact, here in Branson. They actually had a big play down there. And so Lloyd Webber said they decided that their next project would be a biblical one, too. And so the dean of St. Paul's Cathedral suggested doing a story of Jesus. But after some time, they decided to tell the story of Jesus from Judas Iscariot. Not so sure that that's been done too many times. In fact, I don't think most preachers preach the story from Judas Iscariot's point of view. So in 1970, they wrote Jesus Christ Superstar. Now, I can say this as a person who loves music. The music is incredible, but the themes were not. they left a lot to be desired. They were accused of denying the divinity of Christ and making a hero out of Judas. I mean, if you listen to some of the songs, and I've listened to the whole thing, you're scratching your head. What were they thinking when they wrote that? Because it runs counter to what we know Scripture says to us. The Jewish leaders were alarmed that the musical made it appear as if the Jews were responsible for the crucifixion of Jesus. And we know that the Romans actually killed them. And so, but they were fearing an uprising of anti-Semitism because of it. And then there were others that were criticized because they didn't even talk about the resurrection. But Rice says, well, that's because we were talking about Judas and it ends with Judas' death, which I'm not so sure is a real upside to the story. Conservative Christians were startled by the sexual overtones between Mary Magdalene and Jesus. And the one song that was a hit, and I'm not going to play it for you, but the one you can go on YouTube and listen to it. The one song that became a hit out of that play was Mary Magdalene, "I Don't Know Why You Love Me." And you read the lyrics and you're thinking, this is more than just a typical thing, because they were implying that there was some more meaningful relationship between the two that took place. Well, we're not going to play music from that. I just wanted to tell you. But there was another musical that came out called Godspell. Now, Godspell was right out of the hippie playbook. Rice and Weber wrote a really sophisticated rock musical there. This is right out of, you know, hippies and San Francisco and everything else. And they're writing the Gospel of Matthew from a hippie perspective. So all the characters are dressed in weird things. So Jesus, we're going to see a picture of Jesus here, and you're going to say, oh, but remember, the audience is not church people. The audience is a different audience. And there's the Passion of Christ. He dies on a fence instead of a cross, okay? Because what they did is they put it in a modern deal. But one of the songs that came out of it, because most of the music of that was based on old ancient hymns. And the song that many of you know, Day by Day, was a 13th century prayer, and it reached number 13 on the chart. So we're gonna listen to Day by Day, and you're gonna see it as it's in the play. They actually made it into a movie, and please don't be offended by what you see. It's, you know, because it's like, gee, that's Jesus? Okay, but enjoy the music.
Master.
Figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
different. Again, speaking to a whole different counterculture and trying to get the good news. I actually have seen the play. It's actually, the script really stays true to Matthew. It's just, it's like watching in a whole different world because they're putting it in a modern setting. And so you got to see the typology beyond just the surface. So it's not, you know, not watching a typical play. Well, let me share a final thought and then I'll share one more song with you. I believe all good things come from God. Not that all things are good in this life, but good things come from God, and that he's the inventor of music. And that all that Satan can do is corrupt. He's not a there's not a creative bone in Satan. But he takes that which is good and beautiful, and he corrupts it. Corrupts it. And as we said at the very beginning, music is not Christian or non-Christian. It's amoral. Okay? So is country Christian and rock and roll not Christian? Okay? This doesn't make any sense. It's as I said, it's amoral. It's like I tell my students, it's like a brick. That brick can build a cathedral or can be thrown through a window. The brick's amoral. It's the person who picks it up and does something with it that determines the morality of it. It's the same thing it is with music. And so we see in the lyrics, the content that really grabs, it's the message. And that's what we need to communicate. And does that message communicate glory to God? The music is the package that will change from generation to generation. I tell my students who now are in around 20 years of age, about 20 years from now, they're going to feel really old when it comes to music, because there's going to be major, major shifts that we go through. And every generation is going to struggle with this. But the key is we don't want the method, the packaging, so overwhelmed that we lose sight of the centrality of the message. And so I challenge myself, because I'm getting old as I'm working with college students and everything else, may I celebrate that not only the diversity, but God's creativity in terms of how he's doing it. As I see people's lives are being transformed by the power of songs that have lyrics that point us to Jesus Christ. I want to close with one song, and it kind of, you know, those of you who've been on the Monday or Tuesday Tony's deal is familiar with one of these characters. I thought we kind of merged the two sessions together. So I ran across this little thing. It's called The Killer, The Preacher, and The Cowboy. Born in 1935 and 1936, the cousins, Jerry Lee Lewis, Jimmy Swaggart, and Mickey Gilley, they're all about a year apart, and they all grew up together, and they grew up in a poor Northeast Texas area. Each exhibited musical talent at an early age. They were all raised in a Pentecostal church. Jerry Lewis and Swaggart are double first cousins, which means they're cousins on both sides. Really tight-knit, right? Lewis and Gilley are first cousins. Gilley and Swaggart are first cousins once removed, so they're cousins. Lewis is known as the killer. Jerry Lee Lewis is known as the killer for the wild way he played the piano. And of course, as Tony's been talking about, it was a huge hit in the 50s with such rock and roll classics as Great Balls of Fire and Whole Lot of Shaking Going On. Gilley went country. He was a country music singer best known for opening of the world's biggest honky-tonk in Pasadena, Texas. And it was the model for the dance hall in Urban Cowboy, if anyone ever watched the movie. Swaggart, he gained fame as a televangelist. He held crusades and had a television program. Now, what about these cousins? They all married young. Lewis was 22 when he married his 13-year-old cousin in 1957, which led to his career tanking, as Tony's pointed out to us. He ended up having seven wives. Swaggart and Gilley both got married as teenagers. Swaggart was 17 where he married his wife, who was 15 at the time. Okay. Gilley, he decided to wait a little longer. He got married at 17. Well, same with Swaggart, 17. Lewis was the first cousin to make it big in 1956, as I already pointed out. While Swaggart and Mickey were performing grueling manual labor, Swaggart was a swamper and a street preacher, and Gilley was a pipe layer in Houston before they made it big in their music. Jerry's success inspired Swigert and Gilly to find their own paths to success. Now, not that this is a measure of success, but as of the latest, both Jerry Lee Lewis and Swigert had the same net worth, $10 million. Gilly made it big. He's $20 million, his net worth. Now, if you paid attention over the last few years, both Jerry Lee Lewis and Gilly have both passed away in the last few years. So Jimmy Swigert is the only one that's still alive. Three cousins who went, grew up together, went to the same church, played the same music. In fact, Jerry Lee Lewis is banging on the piano, actually had a big influence on Jimmy Swigert and his music in an interesting way. And yet, look at the paths that their lives took. So I ran across this. This was done just shortly before Jerry Lee Lewis died. Jerry Lewis went into the studio with his cousin, Jimmy Swigert, and they did a project of hymns. And so we're going to listen to this song, Jesus Hold My Hand, by Jerry Lee Lewis and Jimmy Swigert.
As I travel through the pilgrim land, there's a friend who walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand, the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, Lord, each day, help me do the best I can, for I need that light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need it now. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Hear my people plead. Oh Lord, look down. I kneel in prayer, hope to meet you there. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand. I may see the blessed way.
Keep me there, I may be holy thine. Sing redemption song someday.
I will be a soul of praise and through that heavenly take or stand.
As I homeward go and daily meet the foe,
blessed Jesus, hold my hand. Jesus, hold my hand. I need every hour. Through this pilgrim land, protect me by thy power. Hear my people plead. Oh Lord, look down on me. When I kneel in prayer, hope to meet you there.
Blessed Jesus,
hold my hand.
I hope you enjoyed that. I wondered what all of us would sound like if we were their age and we were trying to sing. But great song. And again, I thought you might enjoy this. Thank you for being on this journey with us over the last several months. as we look at, again, at the power of music. And I would encourage you, as you go through those times when things get a little, you get a little down, you know, and let music inspire you. Let music lift your spirits. Keep music going on in your apartments and in your place, because music has an incredible way of soothing the troubled spirit, but also lifting our focus heavenward, because that's where our focus needs to be. So I invite you to join me next week as we begin a new study on majoring on the minors, as we looked at the minor prophets. God bless you, and have a great, great day. In Christ's name, amen. God bless you.